There is nothing you can say to me that will convince me that these four chapters weren't a marketing strategy. Do I believe that 1 year ago Kubo made these chapters out of boredom? Absolutely. And as I said in chapter 3, Kubo was definitely going to leave this to an open-ended series, or chapter. It was very apparent to me that Nakano saw this opportunity to try out the waters and saw another big hit. And boy was he right. So chapter 4 was a huge chapter of 55 pages, and while there is a lot to talk about, I think I'll leave my speculations for a discussion video, because to be honest with you, there's quite a lot. And Burn the Witch has left a massive scale plotline to be opened with various outcomes. To get right into the action, I love the fact that there is a massive difference in power when it came to Nini and Noelle versus Bruno, and very happy to see that Kubo didn't let them fight, and even win on some half-assed tactic, because it was very much displayed to us that Nini and Noelle stood absolutely no chance in even blocking an attack. So it was really nice to see the limitation of our main cast and how they can grow and be stronger. With that alone, we got to see what the difference in ranks are and the type of merit that you need to fulfill in order for promotions. Though I understand by saying that, Billy Banks seemed to be promoted and demoted fairly quickly. This in fact is extremely contextual, and we will address that later. Do I think that it's bad that Kubo left us on such an open-ended story? Absolutely not, because be it as it may, on a hypothetical that Burn the Witch did in fact end here, quite honestly every plot point that was given to us all concluded. For example, will Balgo get executed? Why did Nini leave the band? What are the difference between dark and light dragons, and who in fact is Macy? These were the main plot points that we got from chapter 1. And these were in fact concluded. And to all of our surprise, Kubo was able to give us an arc in 4 chapters with everything he wanted to tell, but as well as captivate us for a future reference, even foreshadowing what the story would eventually lead up to with Nini's cover page. Aren't fairy tales full of it? I would say the proper translation, but demonetization. So, you know. So let's start off with the fight with Bruno. The fight with Nini and Noelle got interrupted with Macy's dragon, which was later called Cinderella. Cinderella is one of the 4 supposedly rare dragons that threaten Reverse's London's existence and have been myths even before Reverse London was built, which is an interesting concept to me given how Cinderella was discovered by Macy when the dragon was within its infant stage. So does that mean that Cinderella was the last to be born out of the 7 dragons? Or was it a reincarnation of its previous dragon? Was it the child of the previous mythological Cinderella? Hopefully we'll get these explanations on this dragon lore. But it also seems that in this chapter we got exposition on the other dragons as well, who are also named and referenced in the fairy tales that we're used to. Starting off with Cinderella being, well, Cinderella. Snow White being, you guessed it, Snow White. Red Dress being Little Red Riding Hood, I would assume, or guess. Golden Axe being Goldilocks. Bubbles most likely being Little Mermaid. Sugar House could be a twin dragon with 2 heads, being Hansel and Gretel. And Band of Animals being the Lion King, I would guess. That's the first thing that comes to my mind. Naturally, I would also assume the powers of these dragons follow their trait. For example, Cinderella could use transparency or sneaky magic, whatever you want to call it, much like Cinderella's glass shoe. Within the fairy tale, within the Cinderella story, when it comes to her ash attack, it could possibly also be in reference to Cinderella's sooty look as a non-princess before she transforms. I assume for Snow White, we will get an ice type dragon, who would have thought? Assuming that the concept follows the same mold, this dragon could also make its opponents drowsy because Snow White was sleeping a lot. And she had 7 dwarves, maybe that will be relevant. I don't know, but there you go. It's not obviously to me that the dragons have more than 1 trait, so that's interesting to see where that will go. Though I will say I think I'll leave the other dragons for a theory video, and that's totally not because I can't think of anything for the other dragons at all. No, clearly not. Let's talk about magic wielding. I found this concept even more interesting than I did the last chapter, as I always question what it is and why you don't need tools for summoning spells and magic while at the same time you also do. I'm honestly going to narrow this down to strength, and it seems someone like Bruno's strength level can conjure strong attacks at ease, but when it comes to fighting something like a rare dragon, to really concentrate or to use even more powerful spells, it seems that he does in fact need his tools to execute them. Or it could be that the tools themselves may help accomplish his own speciality. For example, summoning things materialistically out of a paint spraying can, by the way, fits his character design to the T. It tells me that characters like Billy Banks dogs, for example, which we will talk on later, could possibly have the ability of firearms. So if he gets a gun, for example, it could concentrate or even make his ability power even more stronger, which if you saw the last of that chapter, does he really need it? Which goes to say that even Sullivan mentioned that she was glad that she wasn't overestimating the son of a hero, whatever that means. Which again, of course, opens up the doors to ask who this hero is, what the mythology is there, what the reputation is there. Obviously, I would assume that this hero isn't around anymore, so what happened to him? Kubo really made no hesitation in opening this world. For example, in this chapter alone, we got so many open things to say. For example, Balgo's sword that he was able to manifest, and that was just it. He just manifested it. He didn't do anything with it, because the laser then shot Cinderella and killed her, which was from Billy Banks. And the fact of how comedic it was after that chapter had ended was quite funny to me, because it was like, oh, Bruno was the one that got the credit, and you guys got £5, because the rest of your money went to repairing the damage. Even though it was Bruno that created the damage in the first place, I just think that Nini and Noelle got shafted, to be quite honest, and that sucks, because they just fought a legendary dragon, and they got £5 for it, so that's tough. It's also very surprising to me that even though Billy Banks gives off this very nonchalant, very laid-back, lazy attitude and will do anything for a quick buck, it really surprises me how dumb he acts when realistically he's quite powerful and quite smart. And I said that even before in Chapter 3, how his goofiness is kind of showing to be a bit of a facade. I didn't say it specifically like that, but I gave off that intention towards how I was saying it. And it seems that Sullivan is really maybe the only one that understands who Billy Banks is. So when it comes to the promotion that he got at the end of the one shot and got his demotion at the start of chapter one, which I think is weird how they're going to do it in the movie, to be quite honest with you. We'll have to see how that goes. It seems to me that Sullivan alone probably has enough power and influence to get someone like Billy Banks a promotion, going by how much he knows how strong he is and given his reputation. But it also tells me how all the other Horns probably don't know about his feats or his reputation as well. So it tells me that Sullivan really has a big influence. As far as Bruno goes, there's a lot that I need to see with Bruno. For example, he put on the face mask or the balaclava, which did in fact move, like it had its own magic ability within it, because obviously it does look like a Ronkar mask. It does look like Grimmjow's mask, which looks epic as but it was also shown in some manga pages too that the mask in fact did change. It did move, like it showed an open mouth and it showed a closed mouth. So again, it goes to show that Kubo has given us these hints through visual appearance alone, but with little explanation. And I hope that obviously these things can get explained later on down the road. If you guys have ever read Bleach, Kubo demonstrates his storytelling through visual paneling. Obviously, he doesn't outright tell you. He'd never hold your hand when it comes to this stuff unless it's necessary. So if you're going to look for little details, Kubo throws these things very smallly through like Easter eggs, or like tells the story through visuality. That's sometimes a bit of a problem if you're reading something weekly, because you never really get it until you carry on reading later on. And then when you go and read back, it makes sense. So I want to know what that did for Bruno, what that mask did for Bruno. I want to see, obviously, what these magic tools do, which I think is important. I think the speed that Noelle and Nini have as these witches is very fast, as I mentioned in Chapter 3. How Nini was able to get behind Bruno so quick without him really realizing was a speed feat in and of itself. And I think Kubo again demonstrated that when one of Cinderella's ash attacks was about to get really close to her face, and the next panel you see, she's already like gotten herself into a very safe distance away from the explosion blast. So again, very interested to see how strong Nini and Noelle are, so we can actually compare them to someone like Bruno, so we can compare them and see what the threat level is, because I think it's important to show how strong your main cast of characters are, so we understand the threat level between the captains or even the rare dragons. The fact of the matter is that yes, we know that Nini and Noelle are strong, we know that they are incredibly fast, we know that Bruno absolutely demolishes them in whatever skills that they have, but we know that Bruno is strong, so the other captains must be strong, and if the rare dragons are even stronger and causing Bruno, I mean, for example, look at Cinderella, damaged the wing of Bruno's dragon, right? Obviously that's a strong dragon. It broke through Noelle's barrier like it was absolutely buttered bread. You know, it was nothing. So when it comes to these rare dragons, they've already cemented a feat within themselves to show them how strong they are in comparison to the higher-ups of Reverse London and its government. So that's kind of cool in the way of we get to see Nini and Noelle possibly get to that strength later on down the story. We also get to see some development with Bruno, and hopefully we get to see the other characters, the other people in the government actually do some work too. And I think that's really important because, but with Nini and Noelle, they seem to get the job done fairly quickly, fairly swiftly. Yes, they may take damage here and there, but they seem to be getting the job done. What do these captains need to do to also have a challenge? These rare dragons are probably a perfect example of that, and definitely Cinderella has definitely thrown in a big appearance. And if Cinderella is the last one, hypothetically, to be born, if this is the first time that this dragon has transformed into this, imagine the other older dragons that have probably had more experience. So that's going to be interesting. Also, Kubo, I feel he tried to throw in something with Balgo, with the, I'm going to call it the Excalibur sword, since as this is, we're going on to some English UK mythology. I would assume that that sword is probably going to be an Excalibur or some sort of saber. The fact that Cinderella stopped and paused when Balgo used the sword goes to tell me that it's quite possible that Balgo might be a trigger, which was stated at the end of the chapter where Balgo got his termination completely wiped, and they're going to use him to get the other dragons, the other rare dragons, towards him. It seems like hopefully they don't try and kill him after we've defeated all these dragons, for example. But it goes to tell me, thankfully, that Kubo has more in store for Balgo in the future, because he's been a bit of a comedic character, so to give him some relevance would be amazing. And I think to end off this review, the hug with Noelle and Balgo was truly beautiful, in the sense of, like, yes, there's always comedy there, yes, Noelle has always been quite nasty to him, so to say, and I finally understand why. It's because Bruno even said to them, why didn't you tell Balgo that he was going to get eliminated in the future? Why did you keep that secret to him? And they were like, actually, the best form of mercy is to keep them ignorant of their future. And I think the fact that Nini and Noelle always kind of knew that, and they always treated him or kept him at a distance, was in hindsight to kind of help themselves from not being too upset for when it happens, to protect their own feelings and their own situation, because obviously they didn't want to get too close to him because they didn't want to get too emotionally attached. And now that Balgo's restriction has been lifted, Noelle could finally show some sort of emotional attachment, and she could kind of let go of that tense emotion that she was potentially feeling. So I thought that characterization through this chapter at the very end with Noelle and Balgo was truly amazing, and I want to see how Nini starts reacting to Balgo from this point forward. So we're gonna have to wait a few weeks or maybe a few months before we get season two, but I thought this was a great set of chapters and a great way to start off a seamlessly really good story. So I am gonna leave it off with that. What did you guys think of the chapter? Is there anything that you guys want to speculate or talk about for future videos? Please hit it up in the comment section down below. If you want to talk about more about Burn the Witch, there is a Discord link. There's obviously Twitter if you want to go follow me on that for any kind of leaks or spoilers or news in the future. Please obviously hit up the Patreon if you want to see the live reaction to the animated film that we'll be getting on the 10th of October. And there is also a Reddit in the description down below too. So please hit that subscribe and that notification bell. I'm going to catch you guys later. You guys, of course, have this fine day. I've been Hanson, and as always, people, peace out.